Good morning, everyone. Okay, we are about to begin the service now, so we ask that the cassette be rolled in and that everyone be seated at this time as we are about to begin the service. At this time, we ask that the church stand. Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever thou hadst formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. Thou turnest man to destruction and sayest, return, ye children of men, for 1,000 years in thy sight are but as yesterday when it is past, and as a watch in the night. Thou carriest them away as with a flood. They are as a sleep in the morning. They are like grass which groweth up. In the morning it flourisheth and groweth up. In the evening it is cut down and withered. For we are consumed by thine anger, and by thy wrath are we troubled. Thou hast set our iniquities before thee, our secret sins in the light of thy countenance. For all our days are passed away in thy wrath. We are spent over, we spend our years as a tale that is told. The days of our years are 70 years and 10, and if by reason of strength they be 80, yet is their strength, labor, and sorrow, for it is soon cut off, and we fly away. This is the word of the Lord. At this time, I want to say a special welcome to the family and friends of Mark Thompson, who is now deceased as we celebrate his life. I pray that this service will be orderly conducted and that each one will do according to that which is in the way it should be done. And so I want to greet you, and I hope that we all will cooperate. We will now have the opening hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Great is Thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not, Thy compassions they fail not. As Thou hast been, Thou forever will be. Great is Thy summer and winter and spring. You may be seated. At this time, we will now have the first reading, 1 Thessalonians 4, verses 14 to 18, and this will be done by Ramin Dawes, Nevio, and Lionel England, Jr. Nevio. We will have these two persons reading the first lesson.
Good afternoon, everyone. This lesson is taken from 1 Thessalonians 4, verses 14 to 18. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him.
For we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him.
According to the Lord's word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep.
For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet of the call of God, and the dead in the Christ will rise first.
After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we will be with the Lord forever.
Therefore, encourage one another with these words.
Thank you.
We will now have Omar Clark, a family friend, with a tribute. Omar?
Good morning, everybody. I stand here to represent my immediate family and also the Customs family. And I'm just realizing now that the Thompson's family is actually my family, because I basically know everybody, I just couldn't link them together. I just want to extend my condolences on behalf of my immediate family and Customs family.
God sent his son, they called him Jesus, he came to love, heal and forgive, he lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives, because he lives, I can face tomorrow, because he lives.
Roy Thompson, brother, and Rossi's brother and sister fraternity. We will have it in this order.
Greetings, everybody. Could we have a moment of silence, please? 1 minute of silence. Thank you, Jesus. Peace be within these walls. Prosperity within thy palace. I can remember my brother Mark because we were brothers, and it's now six brothers. with 12 of us with one mother. But we have other brothers, but I can't put the finger on it now to count all of them. But I'm just happy to see everyone that is here this morning. I'm happy to see the settings, and I just want to thank you for making the time out of your busy schedule. I really appreciate it. It's just sad to know that Mark have to go, but we know God knows everything, and he is the author and the finisher of everything. I can tell you, the death of my brother tightened a screw in me. It tightened a screw in me in the sense that, I don't know why, but as I say, God knows everything best. And it's just sad to know that we have to be here this morning. He's looking so good in his picture, but he's not here with us. You know, when I got the news this Sunday morning, it was a sad news, but I just thank my sister when she broke the news to me, because she tried. But there was a vision earlier in the night, so it wasn't too hard for me to realize what had really happened. But you know, when I went to the autopsy in Kingston, and when I saw my brother in the body bag and lying on that table, that's the time I realized I'm not going to see him again in this life. But I know So I just want to say, may the good Lord bless and keep you, whether near or far away. May the long awaiting golden day my brother, soul rest in peace.
good morning. And we are here today to celebrate the life of Marco Polo. And if you guys are wondering what this flag means, what this flag represents, I don't know if you all notice he's draped with a flag. And Marco is a part of Rossi's soccer team and school. He attend Rossi's, all of us here, and I just want to say I would want our rest of our entourage. By the way, the flag we present Rossi's, you notice we attire this clothes, uniform during the 80, in the 80s. I want to acknowledge our coach, Mr. Henry. If you just wave on Mr. Henry and Miss Henry, you're a part of the coaching part. Miss Henry was like a mother. Miss Henry was like a mother. And it's good to see Coach Henry here walking to celebrate and be support Mark and the family of Mark. And the team, some of Mark's teammates, I acknowledge them, Rossi's and sisters. So fortunately for me, I attend Rossi's also. I didn't play with Mark, I played before him. But Mark was part of my life. As a young man growing up in Flanka, we used to go to Bottom Road, and Mark obviously come from Granville. And I met Mark during the 70s, about 78. Mark was like 2 years younger. Winston, his brother right there. I only know Mark and his brother. And I want to share this. Me and Mark go way back, and me and Mark have an experience that will stay with me forever. Mark told a white lady, both of us were selling, he was selling peanut, me I sell necklace. And with the white men, people them invite us to the bar over by Chatham Hotel. And we're there, they were drinking and celebrating. There's a pool. And Mark is selling peanut, you know, in a funnel paper wrap. And me I sell my necklace. Mark tell the lady, asks us, what's this? A big almond. And Mark so witty and full of pranks. Mark didn't even let me answer. Mark was like, that's Jamaican mango. That's a Jamaican mango. And the lady didn't hesitate. She took a big bite and feel like, wow, this can't be mango. There's no flesh on it. And chucked Mark off in the pool. We're about 10, 11. Mark was about 8, 9. We didn't even realize that all Mark wanted to do is save his peanut from getting wet. Unfortunately, it didn't matter because all of us were like, that was a lesson we learned early on in life, dealing and taking on. You know, we didn't complain, our parents didn't have it. We went out and tried to make an honest living. Most of our peers were pickpocketing and all of that. So I respect Mark, and I saw him play for Rossi's later on. So let me say, we're there with my brother. I want to tell the family, thank you for allowing us, Rossi's bros, sis, and the rest are there watching. We have a group named Rossi's Brosis, and we come together because of people like Mark, Pirate, Cantiel, and others. And this, we never have the opportunity to extend the way our help Mark in the way we wanted in life. But we figure because of Mark, we will look for the signs and see what we could do better for the others, other survivor and other people from our past. So thank you now again. My name is Brian Martin, a.k.a. Big Head. So I'm going to let Chinny and Odyssey say a word. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm not going to hold you more than a minute or two, but we're thankful for this opportunity to represent our school, our alma mater, Rossi's High. And I've always said, I remember in the 80s when we were ridiculed that Rossi's is just buying up football players. These no good from senior school. I am one of those no good from senior school. And Rossi's had rescued us. Rossi's, when we went there, some of us was Ted Bundy. But after we left, we were like disciples. And we're thankful for Mr. Henry, who was like a father figure to us. And as much as I heard his brother say that there's 12 and there are some other brothers that he's not aware of, but the brothers are here, and there's quite a few more in the States who wish that they could be here, and we are here representing for them. Finally, I'm going to say, I saw Mark the night before he died. I was talking to him. We were there. He said, may I come check you tomorrow? Because Mark's family is closely affiliated with the White House community. I remember Mark from before Rossi's, when they used to come there with their sound system, and that was the only great music system White House knew. We only knew component set are those things. These men, whenever they come through with the big sound, it was like a carnival. So it was from that time we get to know Mark, and it has been a privilege. And even throughout this time, we kept close. The family may not have known, but as Rossi's group, we were close with Mark. We keep in touch with him. He was always at White House. And so I was saying that the night before he passed, we were on the bottom road and we were talking, and he said that, I'll see you tomorrow. But I guess tomorrow didn't come. But we are thankful that we were a part of Mark's life. And on behalf of the Rossi's family, I would like to say again, great condolences to the family, and may the good Lord bless and keep you. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Edward Chinikyam. I'm a part of the 1983-84 team, which my father, Mr. Henry, has guided us with God and his mommy, Henry. For Mark, he's a peaceful soul. Jenko giant. He hardly talk, he walk past you, and he will heal and you don't hear. And you say to him, say, my youth, you don't see my man. He said, what are you, man? Me cold, man. If you think, Chris, you're good. And I stretch something to him, and I say, no, Chini, man. Don't do me that. We are brother, you know. So, you see, Mark, words explaining how Mark is. But Mark is a pure soul. Pure. Yeah, man, genuine. And I want to take this time out to say to Rossi's verses, on behalf of myself and my family, I salute you. I salute you. Let us not be the ones who don't remember this man. He's a great brother. Live on, Mark. Salute to Mark. Love his word. Spread it.
Okay, at this time we will now have a musical selection from Joshua Clark, followed by Mr. Paul Thompson with another remembrance, brother. Joshua Clark?
Yeah, yeah. All right. Good afternoon, everyone. Yeah, man, good afternoon, my brothers. Why, we grew together, like fence to fence. So uno know the story, you know? So I couldn't miss this for the world. Actually, when I heard, Ricky was next to me, sitting down in Baltimore, and we just burst out because, you know, Ricky and, you know, so my family said hi when I see you guys and stuff, so. All right, this is for the family, all right? and Mark. Thank you, guys.
think I was good before the music, so very emotional harmony. And thank you. First of all, I want to say thanks to all the people that are friends that was genuinely love my brother. And I could say the names, but I'll have to count. And I really, with me and the family, I just want to say thank you. Whether my brother was walking in the street, the way he walks, the way he talks, and the people who genuinely love him and make sure that he's, with all that goes around him and go on around him, they were still genuine with him. And that's the most you can do for a human being, a brother, a sister, or a friend. And I want to thank all of you, and hopefully when you see each other moving around, you remember him that he wasn't just a walk around. He was smart. And he could master stuff in ways that you don't think he could. And we used to sit down and talk, because I knew that he was kind of special. And when I say special, he was who he was, and he was a good soul, he was a good person. And I always try to make sure that he's all right. And I kind of take on a father role, or a big father, big brother, or whatever. And I was always protected with my brothers and my sister, no matter what. And so, in a moment like this, when someone who just, a person that doesn't walk around and try to hurt each people that's like yourself, I just want to give thanks again for the people who really understand who he was. And as smart as he was, me and my brother, we used to sit down. I don't know if any of you know or remember that my brother used to know a lot of German. My brother used to speak German. And I still remember a lot of the stuff that I remember. And the three stuff that I kept was Guten Morgen, Guten Night, and the way we joke around, and how smart he was, teaching me to count, eins, drei, vier, fünf, sechs, sieben. I can go on. He wasn't just a walk around. So I will always love him, and I just want to thank you for coming, and may God bless his soul.
Yes, I want to say thank you all for, you know, all the love and, you know, appreciation for my brother. All my brothers, you know, Kingman, Prince, all of you, you know, respect, and we love you all. And I just want to thank all the people, Pet, and a lot of people that we said could be countless, that, you know, we can go on and on and on. And we see a lot of people, there's so many names. So just want to say thank you. And there's a lot of love, even though there's some negativity out there where we can't understand or disregard for life, you know. We just have to start like the Rushdie's fraternity said, you know, just continue to, you know, spread the love. And we need to, you know, just lift up and care for each other and be more positive. We need more love. the hatred and them thing if you left the place, man. So thank you all.
I see where you have a song here, Sing the Wondrous Love of Jesus. I believe we should sit and sing this song. Let us sit and sing this song. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace, in the worship right now. Lord, get to heaven, what a day This time we will now have the second lesson being read by Chapelle grandniece and Miss Gabrielle Baker grandniece, and it is taken from St. John 14 verses 1 to 6. We will have these two little ones come at this time.
Good afternoon, everyone. Today's second reading will be taken from John chapter 14 verses 1 to 6. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way? Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me.
Here ends our portion of God's holy word. And we say thanks be to God. Amen.
At this time, we will have a virtual presentation. So watch this screen and you will see that presentation.
Yeah, I'm Coach Marco Polo. You know, Marco Polo was similar to another, the slow-moving athlete down there. You know, the pelican and the gravy and the stallion. You know, very slow. Play midfield sometimes, switch it from midfield to forward. You know, always very respectful. You know, very respectful guy. You know, always turn up at training. You know, dressed neat too. You know, dressed neat. And I want to tell you, say, he was a brilliant student as well. You know, a lot of people, they always associate, said, well, once you play football, then things get dumb and everything. But he was not one of them. He was actually, you know, if he had applied himself a little bit more in school, I think he'd be even go to sixth form. But, you know, eventually he didn't apply himself that well. But what I can say, you know, he was a very respectful student, always turn up to training on time. And always, you know, always work hard, because besides that team was not going to leave him. So, you know, he was a pretty good baller still, pretty good midfielder slash forward, you know. Yeah, I remember him vividly, man. You know, but that's just my short memory of him. Yeah, I'm the coach Marco Polo, man. You know, Marco Polo was... Yeah, I'm the coach Marco Polo, man.
Okay, at this time we will be collecting an offering in aid of the Community Services Department of our church here at King's. And so at this time we will be singing this song, "The Lord's My Shepherd," in the tune of "Happy Wanderer."
Thank you.
Okay, at this time we ask the church to just stand as we pray a blessing on the offering. Father in heaven, we thank you for that which your people have given to the advancement of your cause. We pray that you will bless it and may it go to its intended purpose. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, we will now have the eulogy read by Mr. Devon Thompson, brother, and Miss Sharon Thompson, sister. So these two persons will now present us with the eulogy.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. We're gathered here to honor the memories and celebrate the life of our beloved brother, uncle, dear friend. Let us give our Heavenly Father the glory and the honor. Remember, he promised he will not leave us comfortless. Mark Andrew Thompson, or Marco Polo as we all know him, was born at 56 Jarrett Terrace on October 8, 1969 to Miss Olive Davis and Mr. Alfonso Thompson. He was a sixth child of 12 from the Union. He transitioned in August 19, 2023, leaving eight brothers, eight sisters, aunts, uncles, nephews, nieces, and a host of relatives and friends. Even though Mark was blessed with such extended biological family, he was also very instrumental in the inclusion of another brother, Jovan, to the family. Humble, respectful, intelligent, friendly, and caring were all the known traits that we were associated to Mark.
His educational journey began at the Smellies Basic School, followed by the Granville College, where he obtained his primary education. He gained entrance to the prestigious and traditional Rossies High School in Lucy, Hanover, where he spent most of his glorious years improving his personal development as an intellectual student and a disciplined and competitive sportsman.
Throughout his secondary education at Rossies High School, Mark prided himself in his personal appearance. He was always very neat, attired, and saw himself as a real girl's man. He worked extremely hard and was a very committed member of the Rossies football team. He played both as a midfielder and a forward, and worked extremely hard to assist the team to victory by winning the 1987 DaCosta Cup.
Mark was so in love with the sports of football that he devoted a lot of his time perfecting his skills. He was always present for training and traveled to various parishes to participate in numerous matches, as well as missing many valuable lessons as a result. He was also a member of the Drivelers Football Club and the CBA United. Mark still managed to excel academically. He sat several subjects at the Caribbean Examination Council and was very successful, including obtaining a distinction in accounting. We remembered Mark studying late at night until the wee hours of the morning and still managed to journey several miles to another parish to school. His legacy and impact as a sportsman was extended to numerous football clubs, including, as I'd mentioned before, he has made an indelible contribution to the sports, especially in the Western Jamaica, so much so that he has created numerous friendships and, or should I say, brothers for life.
Mark was a lover of music, a legacy he inherited from our father. From his early association and interaction with the family sound systems Exodus, he learned and appreciated many genres of music. He mastered the entertainment industry and subsequently landed a job as a disc jockey at the prestigious Sandals Royals and Sandals Negro Resorts International. He alternated between Montego Bay and Negro locations for many years.
Mark became ill and was admitted to the doctor's hospital and was treated by Dr. Horace Chang and other caring medical practitioners, including dear friend, Nurse Alexander, whom to date spoke very highly of him. His family support was overwhelming, especially from his brother Paul and Andrew.
Throughout his challenges, Mark remained hopeful and channeled his time and energy in his personal sound system as he played daily, especially at his home in Jared Terrace. On a typical day, he would play music and prepare his meals. He would then pause his music, walk to various locations in and around town of Montego Bay to visit family members and friends, or purchase more music CDs, then return home to play his music. Naturally, this was his source of comfort.
Most persons who encountered him on a daily basis spoke of his friendly and caring personality. His favorite time of the year was the week of the famous Reggae Sumfest. Rain or shine, dance hall night would not miss him. The week before his passing, he was extremely excited as he spoke of his anticipation of the Spraga Benz 90s Joyride concert. Sadly, he missed the event as his life was cut short at exactly a week before the happenings.
As we try to come to terms with the major void in our family and the gruesome passing of Mark, we are heartbroken. We are, however, comforted by the words of Job, that the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh. Let us seek comfort in the fact that Marco Polo has transitioned to join the legendary football team in heaven with the likes of Shorty Malcolm,
Bayakete,
Pirate,
Corntail,
Tony Bug,
Beagle, and many others.
Mark, we can just imagine you smiling down on us.
Rest well, Mark. We love you, and words cannot express how much we will miss you. May your soul rest in peace. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you so much. We admire your strength. It's difficult to endure the loss of a loved one, but we pray God's strength will be with you as you go through this difficult time. Remember that God is right there in the midst of your struggles. And if you reach out to Him, I am sure you will feel His presence close to you. May God grant you peace in this difficult time. We have listened to various items on the program, and I have no doubt that we have received encouragement and we have received blessings from the various items. I too have gotten some of the blessings when I came in to young ladies were doing the scripture reading, and they did exceptionally well. We are at that juncture in the program where we listen to the spoken word by God's chosen mouthpiece. His chosen mouthpiece today is the pastor of the Mount Salem District of Seventh-day Adventist Churches, which include King's congregation and also Mount Salem congregation. He is a man of many talents. He's a communication giant. He is involved in all the communication in West Jamaica Conference, covering four parishes. He is the communication director for the West Jamaica Conference of Seventh-day Adventists, and he is the senior pastor for this church. I know he has a word for us today. I know he will encourage our hearts, and the family who is going through a difficult time, you'll receive a word that will help you to look beyond what is and see what is to come. I speak of none other than Pastor Jonathan Myrie. He's a husband, he's a father, and he's a man of God who has a word from the Lord. But before Pastor Jonathan Myrie comes, we will listen to a song that will be done by a family friend, Patrice Hall. Mrs. Patrice Hall.
Good afternoon, everyone. Before I sing, I just wanted to just add something. You know, I've listened to everybody, and one of the traits that I remember Mark having is he was very caring, you know, and despite his mental illness, he was a friend to me. I remember coming from when I was going to NCU, sometimes at night I would be at the bus stop and Mark would wait for me to get taxi to go to Granville. My boyfriend at the time saw me one night and said, "Oh, yeah, talk to Madman." And I said, "No, man, I'm a friend. He's like an uncle." And he said, "Oh." And him and Mark are friends. No, Jackie always said, "Pato, yeah, Mark, so close." But, you know, I don't know. I think he still remembered me as a little girl. Used to come down the yard. So he always showed me compassion and care. He was very caring. And I was really sad to hear the way he passed. That wasn't, trust me. But, you know, in the presence of death, there's always life. And we have remembered him. So as I sing this song, I want you to reflect on the life that we now have and how we can commit our lives to God, right?
Understand. Before the cause of Christ, I have spent my days believing that what he had me be is who I am. As I come to see the weaker side of me, I've realized his grace is what I am. When sin demanded justice for my soul, mercy say no. Am I gonna let you go? Am I gonna let you slip away? You don't have to be afraid. Mercy say no. Sin will never take control. Stood face to face, darkness tried to steal my heart away. But thank you, Jesus, mercy said no. Oh, yes, for God so loved the world that he sent his son to save us. From the cross he built a bridge to set us free. Oh, but dear.
it's still a war that rages, that makes a sacrifice so hard to see. As midnight fell on crucifixion day, the light of hope seemed all so far away. As evil tried to stop redemption's flow, mercy said no, I'm not gonna let you go. I'm not gonna let you slip away. You don't have to be afraid. Mercy said no, sin will never take control. Life and death stood face to face. Darkness tried to steal my heart away. But thank you, Jesus, mercy said no. And now in heaven knocks at me, it's through the blood of Jesus, reminding me of one day long ago.
Members of the bereaved family, Pastor Floyd White, Associate Pastor for the Mount Salem District of Churches, Elder Orville Clark, other leaders of the church who may be present, friends and well wishers, I greet you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Death is cruel, and whenever a family has to deal with the loss of a loved one, it is never easy. And there are times when no words can suffice to comfort a family. The Bible described Job in the midst of his grief and loss. His friends came to visit and could find no words to say. For 7 days they sat without saying a word. But sometimes you can't find words to articulate words of hope and comfort to loved ones. But I want to commend you today into the hands of the Almighty God, that as you grieve the loss of your loved one, Mark Thompson, as you grieve his loss, know that there's a God who provides hope and comfort. There's a God who is very near you even now, and that his loving arms are sufficient to keep you in this most difficult time. The songwriter says, when you can't trace God's hand, you must learn to trust God's heart. And so, please, on behalf of my family and I, please accept our condolences on your loss. We keep you in our prayers and pray that God will strengthen you in the days to come that you will be able to find peace in the Almighty God. Generally, when I come to a funeral service, Sister Marva, I use it as an opportunity to preach a long sermon. Because some people, we only get them at a funeral. So the pastor must capitalize on the opportunities for them to get maybe sometime a 3-month stock of sermon. So, and Pastor White is telling me to take my time. But I'm mindful that we have another part of the service to do, and there are some clouds on the horizon, and I also have another assignment out of this parish. And so you will bear with me, but I promise you, I will finish before 4 o'clock. So printed in the program is a message from Pastor White, but I've chosen to relieve him of that burden today because he had to preach this morning at 5 a.m. for our week of prayer that goes on in the early morning. So he had to preach early today. So I didn't want to burden the young man, so the older man is burdening the church today. But as you reflect on Mark's life, it seems as if there is a Russian flag that is on his casket. When I was growing up, we did not like the Russians too well, you know. Yeah. My school is the second oldest school in the Caribbean. Right? The Mannings. And so you will understand why we and the Russians were never, ever good friends. But for this gathering, brothers and sisters, I have to give due respect to my friend who is a Russian, and I give due respect to Mark, a bona fide Russian. We did have some fun, though. Whenever they beat CC, we were happy. We were happy. Whenever they beat college, we were happy. Yeah. So I speak to you for these next few minutes on a word from the Lord. From the book of Ecclesiastes. And understand why I said I'll finish by 4, because I have to cover 12 chapters. So Ecclesiastes. Written by, they say, the wise man. But he came from a very dysfunctional family. His father one night saw his mother bathing. And when he saw that beautiful black woman with her Coca-Cola bottle shape, he invited her over for tea, and the next thing you know, she was pregnant. Ladies and gentlemen, tea can do some serious things. But she was married, and so he had to do something to save himself. So he sent for the woman's husband from war. But the man, I believe, heard that the woman was visiting the house over there. So the man, even when he was drunk, didn't want to go. So they couldn't give the man the jacket. You know what I'm talking about. So the man was sent back to war. He died in battle. He married the woman, David married the woman, but the Lord said the child she's pregnant with would die. That child did die. But the next child that was born in their wedding, a marriage rather, Solomon. So I tell you that to say that it doesn't matter where you are from, there are some things we do not have any say in, how we come here, who we're born to, which family we come in. But one thing is sure, that you and I have the privilege and opportunity to make decisions that will determine our destiny. Solomon, this man, God blessed him with wisdom and understanding and riches. And Solomon would write in chapter 2 of Ecclesiastes writing to his son. He said, listen, whatever I choose to have, I could have it. He said, I had riches in abundance. I had silver. I had gold. I had it in abundance. He said, if that were not enough, I planted houses. I build me my houses. I had many houses, as many as I could have. Verse 4, he said, I planted vineyards. I had all that I needed. I had vineyards in abundance. This was a rich guy. He said, I had gardens and orchards with fruits of various kinds. And he said, listen, to make luxury life good for me, I had swimming pools now that I could leisure in. He said, I had it all. I had it all. He said, I had servants at my bidding. At every beckoning, I could get a servant to come to me. Oh, but if that were not enough, he said, listen, I had all the best singers you could find. Beyonce was on speed dial. Jada Kingdom. You got to have Jada. Oh, you didn't know I know about her. He said, I had the best singers. I had the best sound system. Stone Love was a regular feature. I had money. I could do anything I want. I could have anything I want. He said, if you think that was not enough, being a man was jealous of me because of all the girls I had. He didn't have them in bundle. He had them in hundreds. Wives and concubines were at his bidding. Solomon said, I had it all. He said, I turned to myself, verse 12 of chapter 2. He said, I turned to myself and behold, he said, this is madness, folly. All that I have. He said, I was so rich I could have everything. Verse 15, he said, I said in my heart, as it happened to the fool, so it has happened to me. He said, with all my riches, my decisions were foolish. I was making foolish decisions. He said, I got to the place where I hated life itself. Can you imagine that? A man who had everything got to the place. Verse 17 of chapter 2, he said, I hated life itself. He said, when I think about it, he said, man, there's a time for everything. There's a season for everything. And Solomon, as he pens these words to his son, he says, son, when I think about it, all is vanity and vexation of spirit. Because you can have all the money in this world, there comes a time when it makes no sense. You could have all the material things in this world. There comes a time when it makes absolutely no sense. So he goes on in chapter 11. Remember, I said I'm going to chapter 12, right? You get to chapter 11 and he said, listen, young man. Verse 9, he says, rejoice, O young man, in the strength of your youth. And let your heart cheer thee in those days. He said, have fun. Enjoy life. Yes, man. You do what you feel like doing. But he says, listen, man. He says, walk in the ways of your heart. Walk in the ways of your heart and in the sight of your eyes. But. Now, when you get but there, but means that you need to stop and look now. So he says, do all the fun that you feel like doing. Have all the girls you feel like doing. Enjoy life at its fullest in your own eyes. But know thou that for all these things God will bring you into judgment. Solomon says, at the end of it all, you've got to face God. When you do your best or your worst, or what you think is your best or your worst, for there is still a way which seems right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. Brothers and sisters, Christian friends, There are times when the devil makes sin look like it is the best thing, but he's only deceiving you to destroy you. For sin is still destructive. For the wages of sin is still death. But God has granted the gift of eternal life through Jesus Christ. So he said, listen, if you rejoice and you do all you feel like doing, know that God will one day bring you into judgment. And so he reminds us now in chapter 12. He says, now remember your Creator in the days of your youth. God wants us to make full use of our life while we're strong enough. There are a lot of folks who they want to come to God, but they want to come to God when they are old and in the hospital lying on a bed. But God wants you now. God has created you for his purpose. Mark had a purpose. You and I have a purpose. We must determine what is God's purpose for our life and pledge by the grace and power of the Almighty God to do what God wants us to do. Solomon, in his closing words to his son, he says, son, when you think about it, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. He says, fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. This is the sum total of the human life that God has created you so that you could serve him and be obedient to his will. One day God will bring all things into judgment. And there are many people who have a challenge with the Christian life because they believe that when you fear God and obey him, you have lost most things in your life. That you're not living any life anymore. But everyone who chooses God, everyone who is on the Lord's side is on the winning side. I didn't understand what being on the winning side was all about. I told you which school that I went to. Last year, I was very hopeful with the Da Costa Cup to finally celebrate as a true blue blood. But Clarendon, came and, well, this year we didn't even make it to the 16 over. The only good thing is that the Russians are not there either. But when I was in high school, I went to high school as a cricketer. But the cricket field at Manning's was behind the school. And I realized very quickly, my friend Marva, that the girls don't come to the back of the school. They stay at the front. So the popular people were the footballers. So I switched to play football. And I wasn't too bad, but I had a challenge. Our school used to have these football competitions, the class competition. But I was in a first form class that these boys could not play football to save their life. So we lost all the matches in our class competition in first form, in second form. But in third form was a little bit different. Third form, I had a form teacher that had migrated from England to Jamaica. And he used to be a part of Manchester United. No, I know Red Devil, but Manchester is not red these days, it's blue. I'm sorry. Decided to put that one in. But we had good hopes because Mr. Brown would teach us a little bit more, so we got better. We got some coaching from him and we got better, but we still lost. I was on a losing team. I didn't understand what winning was like. And then when we had our best team at Manning's, we could only squeeze a 1-1 draw with the Russians. Yeah. No, we took it. But in fourth form, when I got to fourth form now, when my class changed, I was in football heaven because there were guys who I was playing under 16 with
and they were in my class. They were members of the Da Costa Cup team in my class. I thought to myself, yes! We ran through those other teams, Pastor White, like they were not there. We were in the finals of fourth form class competition. And I thought to myself, truly, finally, I will taste victory. I'll be on a winning team. The team we were about to play in the final, those guys were no Russians. They were no good. We could run over them. But during the game, when the game started early, one of our defenders passed the ball and hit the ball without looking where the goalkeeper was. The ball ended up in the back of the net. Now, our opponents discovered something about football, that if you have one goal is enough to win any football match. You just need to make sure that the team don't score more. So they decided they didn't want to score any more goals. As we would say, they plant the bus, they park the bus before the goal. We played our hearts out, and we could not score a goal. We lost. My world was distraught. I would have to wait one more year. Unfortunately, my friend damaged my knee that year, and so I could not play anymore. But since I have come to the church, since I've accepted Jesus, as I was a Christian then, I've come to know that I didn't need to win a football match to be on a winning side. I didn't need a trophy in my house to be on a winning side. For when you've got Jesus, you're on a winning side. When you have Jesus, you're on the winning side. For Jesus is a winner man. My Bible tells me that even in heaven, when the devil forged war with Jesus, that there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels, they fought against the dragon, and there was no place found in heaven for the devil and his angels. You see, Jesus defeated him up there, and Jesus defeated him down here. And one day, sin will be ultimately destroyed. In 1 Corinthians 15, the Bible says, Jesus will not reign until all enemies are under his feet. And the last enemy that Jesus shall destroy forever and ever is death itself. And death that has gripped Mark and taken him from his family, death will one day be destroyed. Jesus is victorious, for he himself conquered death and the grave. When death took a hold of Jesus, they buried him in a borrowed tomb. But on that Sunday morning, Jesus came out victorious and had the keys to hell and to death and the grave. For no grave can hold his body down. And everyone who chooses Jesus will one day be on the winning side, and will rise victoriously with Jesus Christ. May God bless and comfort you today, and may we all be on the winning side.
Amen. We are on the winning side if we are on the side of Jesus. Death may have won the battle, but Jesus has the victory. We don't have to worry about what's happening today. I love the song, Mercy Said No. I love the message, Jesus is the winner, man. And we are on the winning side, and we are leaving this place today with that in mind, that we shall be victorious if we keep on the side of Jesus. It's not the popular thing, Pastor Mary. A lot of people, the Jesus thing is not wearing today, it's not the fashionable thing, but it is the right thing.
Amen, benches now. It is the right thing. We are here, and we are going to pray for the family. We are going to present the family to Jesus. They will need encouraging words. When you see them, don't think they are okay. Give them a word of encouragement. When you are by yourself and they come to mind, just say a word for them in your closet, in your private moment, wherever you are. Because one day you will need the prayers of the others too. We all will endure difficulties and trials and tests, and death will invade our family space too. And I'm telling you the truth. We are going to need the same prayers we offer to somebody. So we are going to stand, accepting the family members. Family members, remain seated, please. We are all going to stand. We're going to have a word of prayer for the family so that they will receive strength to go through their difficult time. Shall we pray? O gracious God, our Heavenly Father, thank you for the message we have just received from your manservant, reminding us that the best time to serve you is in our youth, reminding us that Jesus has defeated death, and we can also be victorious if we allow Jesus to be our master. Thank you so much, O Father. We pause just a little while longer to lift up the family members who are grieving, who are experiencing a void on the inside. Oh God, they are crying and they are experiencing loss of a loved one. But we know that you are right there next to them. We just want them to understand that you care for them. May they remember in their difficult moments that Jesus cares. May they remember in their difficult moments that you can help them to get through this patch of grieving. Oh God, we pray that you will hold them in the hollow palm of your hands. We pray that when they cry tears, when the tears cascade down their cheeks, they will remember that you have promised that you will wipe away not some tears, but you will wipe away all tears from their eyes. May you bless them. May you keep them. May you give them strength to go through this difficult time. And may you remind us to lift them up on the wings of prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
At this time, we will have Miss Sharon Thompson coming to give the appreciation.
Good afternoon again, everyone. So, in everything we do, we must give thanks, right? And as we are gathered here in this solemn moment, we, the family of Mark Thompson, Marco Polo, would like to take this opportunity to thank you all for coming to celebrate his life with us. We thank you dearly. We have been overwhelmed with the outpouring of love, prayers, and support that you have shown to us during this difficult period. We thank you for your comforting calls and support. There are, however, some persons that would like to say an extra special thank you to. So the pastor and members of this lovely church, we want to thank you for hosting us. Thank you very much. We enjoyed your message and the ambience, and I'm sure most of us will definitely come back, right? Okay, we want to thank the committed, hardworking policemen officers at the Freeport Police Station. Continue to be relentless as you make Jamaica a safe place to live. To the awesome, wonderful, caring Rossi's Brosis fraternity members, Coach Henry and his lovely wife, Big Ed, Papa, Diane Butner, even though she's not here with us today, Fagerty, UK, for all those calls throughout this challenging times. We want to thank you very, very much. And I must say also that Mark was very much aware that you were trying to reach out to him. And as I mentioned before, during our conversation the week before his passing, I mentioned to him that you were definitely trying to reach out to him. And he told me that he was going to come and see, you know, definitely get in touch with, you know, the fraternity. And as such, I just want to let you know that your mandate has not gone in vain. Mark was definitely aware that you were trying to reach out to him. And I'm sure, knowing Mark, that smile that Mark always has on his face, Mark is now smiling down, you know, at his brothers, right? And we want to tell you many, many thanks. I must say to our brother Paul and Andrew, we know that you were always there for Mark, that extra special support that you always given Mark. As the other siblings, we are very, very grateful to both of you, and we want to tell you that all your efforts have not gone unnoticed. We really, really appreciate you. Okay, and with that said, we would like to take this opportunity to invite you to join us as we, after the committal, to, we have two repasses, one for those who are unable to journey to the far distance. So there's one at Westgate Holy Trinity Church and one at the Martins Mansion. That's Big Ed Mansion at Rose Hall. So please come and join us. And thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. And we love you, and thank you very much for your support.
And so at this time, I want us to listen carefully to this instruction. We will be singing the closing hymn. After we would have sung the first verse and the chorus, the platform party will be leaving, and we ask that the pallbearers will take their stand. And while we are on our way, the family members will join us, and after which the rest of congregation will follow. So we're going to stand and sing now, Precious Memories, Unseen Angel.
My soul.